She was a lovable 20-year-old who wanted nothing more than to protect and serve.
She had a passion for law enforcement and wanting to help people.
He was the hard-nosed cop who made her heart swoon.
She was looking for love, and she met a Prince Charming.
He was the man to have, the man to be with.
But their hope for a fairy tale future slipped away when one of them unexpectedly disappeared.
It began as a missing persons case. The young mother and her child missing was extremely concerning.
I'm looking for my daughter.
As the frantic search for mother and child intensifies, investigators soon find themselves caught in the middle of a case riddled with deception, subterfuge, and unspeakable evil.
It was all going to explode.
He had over 20 pictures of women in various naked poses that I guess he kept as souvenirs.
We all ask, where is the baby?
June 2nd, 2011. As evening falls in suburban Maryland, police are in the midst of a desperate search. 20-year-old Wynetta Wright and her 11-month-old daughter, Jaylin, have been missing for 3 days.
Wynetta's mom, Yvette, became concerned because she hadn't been able to reach her daughter.
Wynetta's family was frantic because they knew how out of character it was for her to disappear. Immediately, they suspected something very bad had happened to her.
There are a few clues pointing investigators in the right direction. Finally, police catch their first break.
Wynetta's car was located about a quarter of a mile away from the Hillcrest Heights Community Center in a apartment complex, right on the Washington, D.C. line.
The car was parked in the very back of the parking lot, away from the building. It was hidden from view.
The vehicle also had 10 windows, which made it hard to see into the vehicle.
Called in.
Officers notified dispatch of their discovery. As they await a search warrant for the vehicle, they plan to keep a close eye on their first piece of evidence.
They crawl up and slap a GPS locate device on the car, and they sit back and watch it, hoping that whoever stole the car is going to come back and pick it up.
As police maintain surveillance on Wynetta's car, additional law enforcement fan out and search the area, including a nearby nature trail.
Police send out officers going in all directions. They expended a tremendous amount of man hours walking in the area, looking for any signs of Wynetta and her baby, Jaylin.
While officers were searching the park, they located an odor which they believed could be decomposition of an animal or person.
Officers follow the scent, and around 7 p.m. that evening, they make a gruesome discovery.
Police went back into the woods, and there was a trail going back to the creek behind the park. Off to the right of the trail, they found Wynetta's body.
You're dealing with a young woman who's 20 years old. When her body was discovered, It was shocking and sad.
She was shot in the head, which is an indication of execution style. Usually that means that whoever shot you wanted you dead.
The investigation switched to a total different investigative unit. So the homicide unit will now take over, and myself and other members of my unit responded to the scene to take over the investigation.
But why had Wynetta Wright been targeted for murder? At this point, police have more questions than answers.
It could possibly bet, one, that she's a female in the park alone, someone sort of an opportunity, could have been a sexual assault, could have been a robbery.
It was very thick, wooded area where she was discovered, and would lead me to believe that she was pulled into the woods out of view of the public so she wouldn't be found.
There's a reason for any homicide, whether it be for money, whether it be for love, whether it be for a vendetta.
We needed to determine who she was with and who she was speaking with, or if it was just a random act.
But as chilling as these scenarios are, there's one burning question in everyone's mind. Where is Wynetta's beloved baby girl, Jaylin?
There are two people involved, a mother which we have found, but we don't have the missing child. So that makes it more of a mystery. Where is this child?
Born in 1990, Wynetta Wright grew up in a home filled with laughter and love.
Wynetta was a sweet young lady. Her mom was always there for her, and same with her dad. She had a very supportive group behind her.
As it turned out, Wynetta would need that family's support. By the tender age of 16, she became pregnant with her first child.
Like most teenage pregnancies, the teenage father usually don't stick around. So now she's a single parent, and she has to raise that child to the best of her ability.
It wasn't a handicap for her. If anything, it kind of inspired her. And she was determined to make a good life for herself and for her child.
After graduating from high school, she had this ambition about becoming a police officer. And that's when she joined the Prince George's County Sheriff Department Explorer Program.
The Explorers Program is a program for, you know, young people who are interested in law enforcement. It just kind of gives them a behind the scenes look at what this profession is like.
The Explorers Program showed Wynetta her dream of becoming a police officer was within her grasp. But Wynetta also longed to find that special someone to share her life with.
Women, like anybody else, they want love, they want care, they want someone to be there for them. And Wynetta was the same way.
For Wynetta, Cupid finally came calling when she walked into a DC nightclub in 2009 and locked eyes with 37-year-old Richmond Phillips.
She was looking for love, and she met a Prince Charming.
Ladies, ladies. All right. Man, have fun.
Thank you.
Well, hello.
Hi.
You are gorgeous.
Thank you.
Miss Wynetta Wright, huh?
Yes.
He was working part-time at that particular club, but he was also employed as a police officer.
He worked as an investigator in the Vice Narcotics, looking for drug sales out on the street.
He had a job that was like something that you would see in a movie. He worked in one of the most difficult jobs in the department with the street level thugs, drug dealers.
He had dreadlocks, tattoos. He could pass for any street thug.
For Wynetta, Richmond's high stakes job detail, coupled with his undeniable charm and good looks, made him irresistible.
Wynetta was, I think, fascinated with police officers. She was herself interested in becoming a sheriff. He's a very charismatic man. And I believe that she was attracted to him because he was charismatic.
Despite a nearly 20-year age difference, Wynetta and Richmond quickly formed a deep and passionate bond.
Both of them were smitten, and they started to see each other on a regular basis.
She was having feelings for him. And when feelings comes into play, there's intimacy involved.
Relationship began to heat up. And then she got pregnant.
Already raising one child, Wynetta hoped Richmond would step up and become the husband and father she'd always dreamed of having.
Wynetta had the dream, you know, to grow up, get married, have a family, a white picket fence, a dog, and a nice house, and a husband to take care of them.
But when Wynetta broke the news of her pregnancy to Richmond, his reaction was decidedly cool.
Something I need to tell you.
Tell it.
I'm pregnant.
Oh, no.
We can make this work.
Look,
Richmond.
I've already told you about this, okay?
But we can be a family.
Family. Look, if this the way you want to play it, then fine. Because I'm not going to have any parts of this, okay?
He drops her like a hot potato and literally walks away. That did not stop Wynetta.
She decided she's going to raise that child with or without Richmond Phillips.
On June 6, 2010, Wynetta gave birth to a beautiful baby girl named Jaylin. Though Richmond made it clear he didn't want to be a father, Wynetta hoped Jaylin's birth might prompt a change of heart.
She wanted Richmond to be involved in Jaylin's life and be a part of it.
She'd never requested anything from him, not money, not support for the child. She just wanted him to have a relationship with his daughter.
But nearly a year after Jaylin was born, that dream seemed a far reach from reality. Richmond had ceased all communication with Wynetta. Even so, Wynetta was determined to make the best life possible for her and her children.
Despite the fact that he had left her, Wynetta had great goals in life that she was very likely to reach and was in the process of doing so. She was going forward, never stopped going forward.
But that all changed on the evening of May 30th, 2011, when Wynetta and baby Jaylin unexpectedly disappeared. Wynetta's mother, Yvette, began to worry after the two had not been seen for nearly 24 hours.
Wynetta was reported missing by her mother. She provided a description of, you know, her daughter, her granddaughter, and the vehicle. Officers immediately went out canvassing the area looking for the vehicle.
2 days later, they found Wynetta shot in the head.
As they scrambled to make sense of this brutal scene, detectives can't help but wonder if Wynetta's infant daughter has suffered a similar fate.
You're looking for the next clue and the next piece of the story. It's like reading a good novel where you can't stop turning the pages.
June 2nd, 2011. It's been 3 days since single mother of two, Wynetta Wright, and her 11-month-old daughter, Jaylin, went missing. After countless hours of searching, the hunt for Wynetta has come to a tragic end.
Police found the body of Wynetta in the wooded area of a park. She had received one gunshot wound to the head.
She just seemed like a normal young woman who was trying to create a life for herself and for her family.
For friends and family, Wynetta's death is devastating. But equally disturbing is the fact that Wynetta's 11-month-old baby girl, Jaylin, is also missing.
Immediately when Wynetta's body was found, we all asked, where is Jaylin?
The baby was gone. It could have been a kidnapping, could have been a murder, could have been a robbery gone bad. We know the baby obviously couldn't care for herself. And so finding Jaylin was huge.
While search teams continue to canvass the area where Wynetta's body was discovered, a quarter mile away, the officers monitoring her vehicle get the green light to initiate a search of it.
After Wynetta was found in the park, contact was made with the officers that were watching her vehicle. At that point, we made a decision that we should check the vehicle.
But when officers open the vehicle's door, it's obvious something is terribly wrong.
Officers got closer and discovered, oh my God, there's a baby in the backseat of the car.
It was Jaylin, and there was blood coming out of her nose and mouth. And it was clear that she was dead. The police officer that found Jaylin, he cried. He was a veteran of the police force. You know, just devastating.
It was just a very heartbreaking for everybody. The officers wept. Everybody was very affected by it.
Equally devastating is the infant's apparent cause of death.
Jaylin had died because of heat exhaustion and sitting in that car.
The windows were rolled up on this car, and the temperature, according to the forensic reports, could have been as high as 125 degrees inside that vehicle.
With baby Jaylin's death confirmed, investigators are more determined than ever to catch the killer. But the number of crime scenes they have to process has also just doubled.
The vehicle was processed by our evidence unit and submitted to our lab. We have investigators looking for any evidence that might be in the woods or in the surrounding area.
Investigators find their next big clue in the same park where Wynetta's body was found.
A detective actually looked down and he saw what he believed to be blood almost in the middle of the picnic table and subsequently located a shell casing very near to that picnic table.
The round that was recovered was a .22 caliber bullet.
The shell casing was very important in the case because it told us,
officer,
what type of weapon she was killed with.
We found a casing right over here.
DNA connected the blood from the gunshot wound from her head to the blood found right under the table. What we didn't have was a gun.
Police can't help but wonder what Wynetta and her baby girl were doing in the park in the first place.
It's a daytime park. There was evidence that we discovered later of people drinking there and doing inappropriate things. So it's probably not the safest place for a young woman to be with a 1-year-old late at night. Wynetta could have gone to the park to meet someone, and someone could have come by and robbed her, and she fought them, and they shot her as a result.
Could have been a robbery gone bad, and when the carjacker or the robber found out that he had a car with a baby in it, he just dropped the car off.
Wynetta's car was found approximately a quarter mile away from the park. It was an apartment complex.
With so many question marks surrounding the case, police turned to the community for help.
Police started conducting interviews with several people in her neighborhood, her family members, trying to determine if someone wanted her dead.
Wynetta's mother immediately offers up the name of a possible suspect, her daughter's ex-boyfriend and Jaylin's father, Richmond Phillips.
Family members began to share information with the investigators about this man. He was a police officer. He worked undercover. In addition to that, he lived not far from Hillcrest Heights Park, right in that same area.
When detectives learned that Richmond Phillips only lived a mile from there, that was a very interesting fact to them.
Not only does Richmond live near the scene of the crime, but those close to Wynetta claim that in the 11 months since Jaylin's birth, Richmond has made it crystal clear he wants nothing to do with Wynetta or his new baby daughter.
He didn't want anything further to do with her. Didn't contact her anymore. He went on about his business.
Detectives make plans to question Richmond, but before they do, someone else beats them to it.
Wynetta's mom had gone to, you know, Richmond Phillips' house to confront him.
Hello, where is Richmond Phillips? Who are you? You need to go in there and you need to find him.
It was quite a scene. Wynetta's mother, she said, you know what? You have 30 minutes before I come in your house.
As tempers flare, detectives also arrive at the Phillips residence in search of Richmond.
It's okay, calm down.
Moments later, the man at the center of this storm pulls up.
What the hell is going on?
Yes, something. Yes,
yes. Richmond Phillips?
Yeah?
We need to speak to you a moment.
Investigators order Wynetta's mom to stay on the porch so they can speak with Richmond one-on-one. They inform Richmond that Wynetta and Jaylin have seemingly been murdered. The reaction isn't quite what they expected from the man Wynetta's mother fingered as the crime's number one suspect.
You have any information? You know them, right?
Yes, I do.
He was genuinely concerned and wanted to help find whoever did this to Jaylin and to Wynetta.
Have you seen her at all, or have you?
I haven't spoke with them in about a year.
Not only does Richmond seem genuinely distraught by the news of Wynetta and Jaylin's deaths, but he also has an alibi for the night police believe the crimes occurred.
He said he hadn't seen her in a year. He stated that he, in fact, had worked the evening shift that night.
To verify his alibi, investigators reach out to Richmond's superiors with the Metropolitan D.C. Police Department. It turns out Richmond is telling the truth.
Richmond Phillips' story was very believable. There was no problem, and the investigation continued.
But if Richmond Phillips isn't behind this terrible crime, then who is? Soon, another discovery will shift the investigation into overdrive and bring another man from Wynetta's past into the limelight. It's been nearly a week since police in Maryland began investigating the gut-wrenching double homicide of aspiring police officer, 20-year-old Wynetta Wright, and her baby daughter, Jaylin. Wynetta's body was found in the woods of a nearby park, the victim of an apparent gunshot wound. Baby Jaylin's body was found a quarter of a mile away in her mother's car.
Both of us children, technically, and those lice have been snuffed out and taken away. Law enforcement is making sure that justice is served.
When someone shoots someone in the head, they want you dead. We know that whoever committed this crime had to have been close to this person. There was some passion somewhere there at some point.
Initially, investigators suspect Wynetta's ex-boyfriend, D.C. police officer Richmond Phillips, had committed both crimes. But when Phillips' superiors at work verify his alibi, investigators find themselves back at square one.
They had two crime scenes. They had her vehicle, which had the child in it, and then they also had where her body was found in the woods. So they knew someone had taken her there. But who was that someone? From that point, you work backwards and you interview everyone that, you know, may have information.
Speaking to Wynetta's immediate family, detectives soon make a troubling new discovery. Apparently, on the night of Wynetta's disappearance, the young mother had paid someone else a visit, another former lover, and the father of her first child, a man by the name of Wayne Miller.
Police learned that he did have contact with Wynetta within 24 hours of her death.
Wynetta dropped her other child off with Wayne, and Wayne was gonna watch his child for a couple days.
Like Richmond Phillips, Wayne Miller didn't live far from the park where Wynetta was shot.
The police had to do their due diligence and talk to him and see what kind of alibi or what kind of story he was gonna provide to them.
Hoping to get some answers, detectives bring Wayne Miller in for questioning.
Mr. Miller, we're here to talk about the death of Wynetta Wright.
What? She's dead?
Yes.
No, she can't be dead. I just seen her the other day.
When I spoke with Wayne, he was very upset and provided as much detail and information as he could about Wynetta and his relationship with her.
When was the last time you saw Wynetta?
2 days ago.
Where were you the night of her death? I mean, did she drop the child off? Did you go anywhere after that?
No, I stayed at home. We watched movies all night.
They had a very good relationship and they were sharing custody of their daughter together.
He was actually helping care for his daughter, providing her with financial support, and had no reason to do Wynetta any harm. We had extreme or lengthy conversations with him, and it was determined that he did have an alibi, that he was not involved in any way.
For detectives, it's yet another dead end.
You're trying to get to the truth. And so each step along the way, you know there's something more. And as an investigator, you're looking for the next clue and the next piece of the story.
But a week after Wynetta's body was discovered, police receive a startling new lead. One that points them back in the direction of a prior suspect.
I spoke to Wynetta's cousin and she told me that she was actually on the phone with her when Wynetta arrived at the park, and that she was going to the park to meet someone.
Wynetta let her cousin know that she was going to meet with Jaylin's father, Richmond Phillips.
She was really excited. She had Jaylin dressed up in a beautiful flower dress. It was the first time that she was going to show Jaylin to her father.
Police are stunned. Earlier, Richmond had told detectives he hadn't seen Wynetta in a year. Now, one of Wynetta's cousins has allegedly placed him at the scene of the crime.
Wynetta was on the phone with a cousin, going to meet Richmond Phillips in a park, and spoke to her on the cell phone and said, "Here he is now."
But for police, the reemergence of Richmond Phillips as a potential suspect is at odds with what they know about this highly respected officer and his alibi.
Richmond Phillips was a police officer, and then he swore an oath just like I did.
This is a veteran police vice officer. It's no way he could think he would get away with anything like this. He couldn't be that dumb. It just didn't make any sense.
Killing a woman, dragging her to the woods, and leaving his own child to die in a vehicle. It's just very hard to believe that an officer would do that.
Also lending credence to Richmond's innocence is the type of weapon believed to have been used in the attack.
Wynetta was shot with a .22 caliber weapon. Well, that's not standard police issue weapons.
Police officers don't carry the .22 caliber as a service weapon. We also checked Richmond Phillips' gun registry to see if he had owned any weapons. And in fact, he did not own a .22 caliber gun.
Outside of the statement made by Wynetta's cousin, none of the physical or circumstantial evidence points to Richmond as the culprit. But with no other credible leads, detectives decide to dig deeper into their fellow officer's background.
I brought his entire squad in to interview each one of them to see if there could be anything relevant to the case that they might know.
As the stories of the veteran cop begin to stream out, detectives learn that Richmond's personal life was more complicated than they initially realized.
Richmond Phillips was married. He lived with his mom, his wife, and his 12-year-old daughter.
He looked like a family man from all appearances, but his whole life was a lie. He had these other relationships.
Detectives wonder if Richmond's affair with Wynetta and the child he had with her could be a motive for murder.
Richmond Phillips may have had a motive to get rid of Wynetta and to get rid of his child so he didn't have to worry about a second life and paying for a child and causing problems at his own home with his own wife and daughter living there with him.
But the fact that Richmond Phillips is a married man also adds another potential suspect to the list.
the wife possibly was jealous and had gone to that location and killed Wynetta.
So the plot thickens, and we're starting to build a profile of his wife.
Police waste no time in speaking with Richmond's wife, Rita.
We interviewed Richmond Phillips' wife to see what knowledge she had of Wynetta.
Were you aware that your husband was seeing Wynetta?
Absolutely not.
I can't believe he would do this.
This was very painful for her. She was a wife of 15 years. She said he came home every night, took their child to school each day. So she was very shocked by this.
I hope you understand that with the death of Wynetta and her baby, we have to investigate everyone. You're sure you didn't know about the affair?
I'm positive. I mean, I had no idea.
You had absolutely nothing to do with her murder?
No, I didn't have anything to do with this. I was out of town.
Richmond Phillips' wife had been away that weekend and not near the park.
We don't believe that she was involved in this in any way.
But as police close the book on Richmond's wife, they discover she isn't the only woman who might want Wynetta out of the way.
Richmond Phillips was somewhat complexed, should I say. He had other female interests.
We found a ton of naked pictures on his phone, naked pictures in his locker. Richmond Phillips was a womanizer.
Police in suburban Maryland are investigating the heartbreaking murders of Wynetta Wright and her infant child, Jaylin. Initially, the investigation focused on Jaylin's father, D.C. police officer Richmond Phillips. However, upon discovering Officer Phillips was married, detectives wonder if his wife Rita could have gotten wind of the affair and killed Wynetta and Jaylin in a jealous rage.
The wife had been away that weekend and had come home. We knew from her cell records that she was back at the Phillips home at the time and not near the park. She was completely innocent.
But within hours of eliminating Richmond's wife as a suspect, police uncover a slew of evidence that suggests any number of women might have wanted Wynetta dead.
Upon speaking with people that he worked with, we found out that he had several women. He was kind of a womanizer.
In fact, in his locker at work, he had over 20 pictures of women in various naked poses that I guess he kept as souvenirs.
We need to determine their relationships to see if one of them may have been jealous that he had had a child by another woman.
But with only partial photos of these anonymous women to work from, tracking down all of them seems like an insurmountable task. But among the cache of nude photos, there's one woman police recognize, a fellow officer by the name of Karen Hope.
You recognize her?
Is that Karen? From the department?
Yeah.
She had a year-long relationship with Richmond Phillips. She worked at the police department with him. He met her there.
Hoping this could be the break they need, detectives bring Karen in for questioning.
Thanks for coming in and talking to us. We appreciate it.
No problem, anytime.
Okay. We need to know a little bit more about your relationship with Richmond Phillips.
The investigators talked to her for hours. How close was this woman, the mistress, and Mr. Phillips?
Well, we really didn't have too much of a relationship. It was more just casual sex.
Karen was very cooperative. She told me that she developed a sexual relationship with him and that she would meet him at various hotels just for that reason.
You weren't aware that he was already a married man?
Oh, no, I definitely wasn't aware he was a married man.
He was. And he was also seeing Wynetta on the side.
No, I've never heard anything about Wynetta.
The possibility that Karen had something to do with it was questioned. It was ruled out. She gave a credible alibi where she was, had nothing to do with it.
But as the interview winds down, Karen reveals a piece of information that leaves detectives floored.
Well, he'd get undressed and I would just notice he'd have a gun attached to his ankle.
He would carry a second weapon?
Yeah, a pistol, a 22 caliber pistol.
She told us that she had seen him with an ankle holster on and that he had removed a 22 caliber gun from an ankle holster, which was not his service weapon.
It was consistent with the shell casing that was recovered at the scene.
They believed that was the type of gun that killed Wynetta Wright.
Karen provided me with information about the alternate duty weapon that Richmond Phillips carried on his ankle, and I knew that a 22 caliber bullet had killed Wynetta.
While investigators believe Karen's statement about the gun, Richmond Phillips' alibi still seems airtight.
He was working the evening shift that night as a police officer.
But when officers ask around, they discover that Richmond was actually on patrol in the area near the park the night Wynetta disappeared.
Richmond Phillips was alone the night of the murder.
Without a partner to verify his whereabouts that evening, Richmond's patrol schedule clearly gave him a window of opportunity to murder Wynetta. Soon after that, investigators make another alarming discovery about Richmond.
So as the investigators continue to plow through evidence, they learned that the very next day after her body was found, Wynetta was supposed to have been in fraternity court against Richmond Phillips.
She decided to file for a paternity test to try to get some child support from him.
Wynetta has some very strong women in her life, and they had begun to get in her ear in terms of, hey, this guy needs to be held responsible for what he's contributed to the situation.
The paternity suit would have required Phillips to pay support for Jaylin. Plus, he would have been ordered to include her on his health care coverage.
When we start connecting the dots, everything is now starting to align back to Mr. Phillips. He did go to the court that day for the paternity test and for the paternity hearing in the family court. But why would he even voluntarily agree to do that?
But as investigators know, there's only one way to find out for sure.
We needed to speak with Richmond Phillips immediately.
It's been a week since the brutal slaying of Wynetta Wright and her baby Jaylin. Police have zeroed in on their prime suspect, married cop Richmond Phillips, who not only had motive and opportunity to kill his mistress and their child, but also means.
Richmond had multiple relationships with various women, and it was determined through one of the females he had contact with, Karen, she had observed him at one point with a weapon on his ankle.
She said that when Richmond would get undressed, she would see a small handgun strapped to his ankle. Exactly the type of weapon that killed Wynetta.
Richmond Phillips really wanted to avoid a paternity suit with Wynetta. Didn't want to acknowledge that this was his daughter and did not want to have to pay her any amount of money.
It is very likely the judge would have told Richmond Phillips that he had to part with a significant portion of his paycheck. And it seemed to all involved that Richmond Phillips did not want to do that.
But court documents related to a paternity hearing between Richmond and Wynetta seemed to poke a hole in that theory.
But what was interesting is how, at that point, he voluntarily told the court, I'll take a paternity test, sure, no problem. So why would he agree to do that?
Detectives aren't sure, but one possibility is that perhaps Wynetta and Richmond weren't as estranged as everyone thought they were.
We're looking for the things that we can test his story against, and you can see his story starting to evolve.
He had said he hadn't seen her and hadn't talked to her, but phone records show that wasn't the case.
He called her over 100 times the month prior to the paternity test. He tried to reach out to her repeatedly, so his desperation grew as the test came closer. His intention was to convince her not to go forward with this paternity test.
But the frequent calls to Wynetta aren't the only thing Richmond's phone records reveal.
Well, his phone records put his phone in the vicinity of this Hillcrest Heights Community Center park on the night of this crime. It showed as well that there was contact earlier in the evening.
With phone records placing Richmond at the park the suspected night of the crime, detectives pay a visit to the park's manager, who supplies them with surveillance videos from the evening of May 30th through the early morning hours of May 31st.
The surveillance tape confirmed that Wynetta and Richmond Phillips were in fact in this park together. It confirmed the time that he arrived at the park at about 10:30 at night, and also confirmed the two of them coming together to talk. The surveillance showed his vehicle and her vehicle coming into the park that night. It showed the two of them sitting at a picnic table talking.
They stayed there for approximately 8 hours and sat on a picnic bench and talked.
We assumed he was trying to talk her out of making him take the paternity test. In court, the next day,
The surveillance video kind of crystallized all these leads that were a little bit loose. It really tied it all together.
But it's what the surveillance captures just before 6 a.m. on May 31st that's arguably the most damning.
The cameras in the park scan the park. They're not fixed cameras. And so we have Richmond Phillips there with her about 4 minutes before her death, and the next time the camera comes around, her body is laying back on a picnic table.
And then as the camera continues to zoom, the next cycle through, the picnic table's empty. There's nobody there.
At that point, I guess he decides, well, I better hide the body.
So the surveillance video showed not necessarily the crime, but it showed the events leading up to it and the events afterward.
What's worse is that just hours after Richmond Phillips was caught on the park surveillance video, he seemed unaffected.
Richmond Phillips continued his day. He then went to the courthouse and attended the paternity hearing, gave his DNA as he was supposed to.
Investigators knew at that point Mr. Phillips was a suspect for homicide. So the investigators decide to bring Mr. Phillips in.
With video evidence in hand, investigators bring Officer Richmond Phillips in for another round of questioning.
In the beginning, Richmond Phillips is cool as a cucumber going through this interview. He's got this charade going perfectly.
Well, I didn't know if she left, moved, what.
Because of that surveillance system video, I now knew that he had in fact lied to me, that he had seen her more recently than a year.
When he was confronted with the fact that, guess what, there's a surveillance tape, then he starts backpedaling.
Did that happen? Do you remember meeting her there? I met the other lady there.
Eventually, he started to change his story and say that he had met up with her. So we started picking through inconsistencies in his statement.
Oh, I was there, but I left at 3:30. No, you weren't. Your texts show you there. We can see you open the car door at a certain point in the morning. Did she ever try to give you the baby? No, she didn't. Well, why were you walking over to the car? Well, she tried to give me the baby to hold.
You told me a second ago you watched her leave. And now I know that's not possible because she's actually killed that little girl in the car and drive away. Something happens to her at spot.
Richmond Phillips said that he had left her early in the morning, and he's not sure what had happened to her. She was still at the park when he left.
You see where things are pointing to him. Some type of confrontation happened between you and her, which ultimately caused her death. That's basically what I'm saying to you. I think anything happened to her as we talk.
After hours of cat and mouse, detectives are done playing games. They charge Richmond Phillips with 2 counts of murder.
You're under arrest.
At that point, you asked for an attorney, and officers from his agency actually came and took his weapon and badge and told him that he was suspended from the police department.
No outrage, no, how could you do this to me? I'm a cop. He knew.
But even with Officer Phillips in custody, authorities know they have a long way to go before justice is served. And the question still remains, would a jury really believe a husband, father, and respected officer like Richmond Phillips was a cold-blooded killer at heart?
The defense was banking on the fact that people would not believe a police officer to be capable of such a horrific crime.
On January 14th, 2013, more than a year after the deaths of Wynetta Wright and her infant daughter, Jaylin, former police officer Richmond Phillips is led into a Maryland courtroom to stand trial for their murders.
It was just kind of a shocker to everyone that somebody who was sworn to serve and protect his community would kill not only an ex-girlfriend, but his own daughter, his flesh and blood.
Affected everybody. It was hard to see or hear this and not to feel affected by it. It really resonated across our community, and everyone wanted to see justice done.
This wasn't just a family quest for justice. This was a community quest for justice. The highest ranking prosecutor in Prince George's County personally tried this case herself.
All of these crimes affect me, but there is something about hearing that a baby is murdered that calls you and says, you know what, I think I have to take this one. I'll take this one.
In their opening statements, prosecutors assert that around 10:30 on the night of May 30th, 2011, Richmond lured his ex-girlfriend to the Hillcrest Heights Park in suburban Maryland to discuss her pending paternity suit.
Wynetta wanted her daughter to have a father, and I believe that's what she was trying to meet up with them.
That first time, Jaylin was going to meet her father, and Wynetta dressed her up and just made her look so beautiful so that he would see her and want to love her and have her in his life.
Prosecutors say Richmond refused to see Jaylin, and for the next 8 hours begged Wynetta not to go through with the paternity hearing.
I want you to be in her life. She's a beautiful girl.
I told you before you had that baby that I didn't want to have no parts of it.
If we can't figure this out, I'm just going to have to go through with the paternity test tomorrow.
Paternity? No. This is too much
I'm
for
sorry.
Me.
I'm sorry. I can't
handle this.
When it became clear that Wynetta had no intention of dropping her claim, Richmond drew his .22 caliber pistol and pulled the trigger in the early morning hours of May 31st.
He shoots Wynetta in the head, takes her body into the woods, takes Wynetta's car with Jaylin strapped in the car seat out, drives it around the corner, and he puts it in an apartment complex in a visitor parking spot. And so he left her there in the broad daylight to just cook, then walks home.
Memorial Day weekend in May of 2011 was very hot, one of the hottest days of the summer. And to take, you know, your own child around and leave him in a parking lot with the windows rolled up just shows that he had, you know, no regard for the child's life.
As for Richmond's appearance in paternity court later that day, prosecutors claim that too was part of his plan.
He showed up for court the next day because he knew the child and Wynetta would never make it to that courtroom.
Mr. Richmond figured that this was a creative way to avoid paying child support.
He, you know, wanted to hide the fact from his family, his wife and child, that he had a girlfriend and another child.
Well, the paternity suit would have destroyed his ability to be out as a womanizer, because once the scientific test established that he was Jaylin's dad, there was no plausible deniability with his wife.
To back up their theory, prosecutors introduced the park surveillance tape as evidence.
Last time we see Wynetta alive, she's sitting on the table. Richmond Phillips is standing over her right shoulder, and that's the last way we see her. About 2 minutes later, her feet have fallen off the chair, and she is just laid back. Her feet are hanging over the side of the bench.
The surveillance video is damning evidence, as are the witnesses prosecutors called to the stand.
We had about 25 witnesses testify. His mistress came in and identified the handgun. It matched to the bullet in the place where the bullet belonged. The DNA with the blood underneath Wynetta's head on the picnic table, all of it fit together seamlessly.
One of the most poignant and heartbreaking things was when the detective that found the baby testified. He came to that trial at least a year or so removed from the actual event, and he cried like it was yesterday. If he's gotten therapy, I can understand why.
When it's their turn to counter, Richmond's defense team claims that rather than proving their client's guilt, the surveillance video does just the opposite.
They said just because the video showed him with her seconds before she was laying over the picnic table, that doesn't necessarily in and of itself mean that he did something to her. Maybe there was somebody else in the park that day.
Furthermore, there's the matter of the missing murder weapon.
We were never able to find the .22 caliber handgun. Never found during the course of investigation.
The defense also claims that their client simply wasn't capable of violence on this scale. His job was to protect and serve, not to murder and deceive.
People have great respect, in the most part, for police officers. And the defense felt their case was very strong. He's a trusted police officer and an esteemed member of the community.
On January 17th, 2013, both sides rest their cases. After 2 hours of deliberation, the jury returns with its verdict.
Your heart's in your throat before any verdict is read. So this was a nervous moment, waiting for justice to be done for this baby and for this young mother.
When the judge instructed me to read the verdict, I turned to Mr. Phillips, and I never faced evil like that in my life.
He locked eyes with him to read guilty. It was a very powerful moment in the courtroom, very powerful.
And according to jurors, any lingering doubts about the defendant's guilt were put to rest by one simple thing, Richmond Phillips' walk.
During the course of the trial, Mr. Phillips would get up and walk from the counsel table to the bench.
And that walk was compared to the surveillance video, and it was the same walk. That walk was the final linchpin for everyone, especially the ladies. It was pretty much a wrap after that.
Richmond Phillips was sentenced to double life without the possibility of parole. And there were gun charges as well. And so he hopefully will spend the rest of his life in jail.
Although justice was ultimately served in this case, it can't replace the two young lives that were taken that fateful day in 2011. The life of an innocent child and the life of a woman who dreamed of becoming a police officer, only to fall in love with and then fall victim to a killer cop masquerading as one of the good guys.
I think that she could not conceive of someone who appeared to be so responsible, so confident, so sophisticated, could turn out to be the monster that he did. I think she trusted him. I think she loved him. I don't think until the moment he shot her that she believed he would hurt her, much less their child.
The person she saw on the surface was a person who was okay to trust. An officer of the law, an older man, a person who probably made her laugh. She had no idea that her attraction to him would cause her death and eventually would cause the death of her baby. And she had no idea who she'd met that night and what he was capable of.